this is John Cullen with growingyourgreens.com through another exciting episode on a beautiful December day here in Las Vegas, Nevada. And this episode, I'm going to show you guys the Sweet Tomato Lady Test Garden here in Las Vegas, Nevada. As you guys can see, it is December, almost Christmas time. So, of course, being in the festive spirit that Leslie Doyle is in, she's actually got a 40-foot tall live Christmas tree in her front yard, decorated to the hilt with ornaments, as well as a star on top that they climbed the tree to put up there. So wish I could show you guys that at night when it's lit up, but actually I'm not here to show with you guys Christmas trees today. I'm here to show with you guys her amazing Tomato Lady garden here in Las Vegas, Nevada. Now for those of you guys that are longtime viewers, you will have remembered that I made a video 10 years ago now in 2012. Yes, I've been making videos that long. Here with the Tomato Lady, sharing how she grows in the summertime, which is when most people think they could garden in Las Vegas and when most people garden in Las Vegas. But I'm here in December to share with you guys what you guys can grow in the wintertime. Growing in the wintertime is even the better season to grow in Las Vegas than the summertime because the temperatures are cooler, you don't have as much pest pressures, and things grow a lot easier in the cooler weather, although they do grow a little bit slower. So in this episode, I'm here to show you guys what Leslie Doyle, who's been growing for 30 years here in Las Vegas, is growing in the winter, as well as share with you guys some of her expert knowledge and tips so that you guys too can be successful growing in Las Vegas. Some of what I've learned and some of the techniques I know today and I use in my garden did come from Leslie. She has online, little booklets you can download from her website. And more importantly, she will give you guys actually personal private classes to teach you guys how to start your seeds and how to garden in Las Vegas successfully. All right, so this is the front of Leslie's house here in Las Vegas. And you guys could see, when I came here previously, she had a whole front yard and it was basically just all growing vegetables. Since then, she's getting a little older. She's in her 80s now. She's still gardening, but she doesn't bend down as much anymore. So she has a lot more pots with, vegetables in there that are getting automatically watered. Another very important tip from her: you want to have automatic watering systems in the desert. Don't rely on hand watering because your plants will not make it. She also is growing plenty of fruit trees, including apples, peaches. She got pistachio, nut trees, and here's a grapefruit. She has several grapefruits as well as kumquats and Meyer lemons. So actually this is a grapefruit tree that's, produces fruit every year for her. But I want to next show the guys in the front yard the Meyer lemon that is her best performing citrus tree that I remember showing in the episode I made 10 years ago here in this very spot. So let's see how it's growing 10 years later. So if you guys want to grow a citrus tree in Las Vegas, my number one recommendation for you, and probably what Leslie would say also, is to grow a Meyer lemon. Meyer lemons do amazing, and I believe this is an improved Meyer lemon if my memory serves me correctly. And we are here in December now, and I don't know if you could see all the fruits on there, but check this out, guys. If I literally lift this branch up, I mean, the Meyer lemons are just packed inside the interior of this tree. I don't know if you guys can see that, but it is insane how many Meyer lemons is on this tree. So yeah, definitely, if you're planting citrus, definitely get a Meyer lemon. It's gonna be your best bet and you'll have lemons for days. Another fruit tree I want you guys to plant, if you guys wanna have a low maintenance fruit tree that can look amazing, but also provide you guys food and sustenance, especially if you need to be able to fit something in your HOA in the front yard that doesn't look like a fruit tree. What that is the olive tree. So this olive tree is huge. It's basically a black style, maybe mission olive style. And it's huge. It's got lots of black olives on there that'll drop and will stain your driveway and the concrete down below. But I want you guys to harvest your olives and cure them. Olive trees are, Mediterranean, and they'll grow great in the Las Vegas climate here. And she has lots of olives she could harvest. And the cool thing is here in Vegas, because it is so hot, some of the olives will actually dry on the tree, or even when they drop and you could eat them and they're less bitter. and you pretty much don't need to even process them to make them edible. All right, so now we're gonna head into the backyard, and that's where the sweet tomato test garden is. And Leslie actually used to write for some gardening magazines, and they would actually have her do trials for the desert gardening to share with the magazine, like what kinds of seeds will do well here. So over the 30 years she's been gardening here, she's found the exact variety of tomatoes and other kinds of plants that will grow the best in Vegas. Plus, you know, it took her a good 10 years to learn all this stuff because she learned by trial and error. But now after 30 years of growing, she really knows her stuff, right? So yeah, let's head into, oh, and the other thing I want to mention, you guys, is that she'll do garden tours. So hey, give her a call. She's a very friendly and nice, and say, hey, Leslie, I want to come for a class and take a garden tour, and she'll be glad to help you out, give you guys a private tour and class, help you start seeds, and share with you guys all her knowledge about gardening. So she is one amazing resource here in Las Vegas so that you too could be successful gardening, because I know a lot of you guys that live in Vegas have tried and you've failed. Well, you guys need to learn from an expert, whether it's me and my YouTube videos or learn from Leslie directly. All right, so anyways, let's go ahead and head back into the sweet tomato test garden winter edition. All right, so now we're in the backyard. I'm gonna show you guys Leslie's amazing garden, what she's growing in the winter time. And she's got all the raised beds and they're all planted out with winter crops. Now, my one comment would be that she needs to harvest more of these winter crops and eat them. But I always encourage you guys to not only grow the food, but also more importantly, include them in your diet. You know, all the greens of this time of year could be eaten in salads. They could be blended into green smoothies. They could be blended into blended salads. Of course, I recommend vacuum blending. You could also just harvest these greens and steam them, cook them up in the Instant Pot, boil them. There's many ways to use your greens, and I want you guys to get the greens in you. They're one of the most nutritious foods you guys could eat that is unfortunately under-eaten, and that's the main food you could be growing in the wintertime. All right, so what I thought I'd do for you guys next to make it a little bit easier is just I'm gonna go ahead and do a hand cam tour and show you guys the specific cultivars and varieties she's growing. You know, she does start all her seeds here herself in the little greenhouse over yonder, and then she gets them planted out in the garden. Of course, it's Christmas time, so they got some decorative Christmas tree decorations. But behind the Christmas tree, they got lots of things planted. It's very important, you know, to stagger your planting and plant at the appropriate time. In September even, I think we're still getting some 80, 90 degree weather days, and that could, you know, mess up your winter planting if it's still too hot when you plant them, because the plants may want to bolt. Most of her plants looks like they're doing amazing. So let's go ahead and take a look at what she's planted. So she's planted Swiss chard. Maybe like that's like, that's around 8, 8, 22, that could take some of the heat. Over here she's got the cabbage ruby that was planted 8, 22. You guys can see how nice that's looking. Planted the cauliflower 8, 4, 22. So man, that's still like August. I would have planted it a little bit later because I still got my summer stuff going. Also, she does have the reflective mulch down on the ground that she does use in the summer. And that prevents like the aphids and the white flies, reflects some of the heat on the underside of the leaves of the tomato plants and the other vegetables she's growing. Also kind of keeps the soil a bit cooler in the winter time. The soil temperature is probably about the same whether it's covered or uncovered, but it does help retain a little bit more moisture, which is really not too much of an issue in the winter time. Over here she's got some white onions planted. She's got some Chioga beets, as well as the bull's blood beets, which I love because it has a nice red leaves or purplish leaves that look really pretty, but also they're more nutritious. And of course, over here on 9/8/22, she planted a whole row of the pak choy. Looking amazing. And as we walk down here, you can see the last pak choy bolted already. And that's probably because it was stressed out when it was young. But I want to let you, I want to go ahead and give you guys a close up on this and talk to you more about the pak choy and its flowers. All right, so as you guys can see, this plant is bolting. And when the plant bolts, that means it kind of goes to its next stage of life. Normally, when pak choy or bok choy is harvested, it's harvested just small, you eat the leaves, but when it bolts, that's all right. It's still 100% completely edible. You could harvest little small baby leaves as they come off. In addition, you could also harvest the little baby flowers. These flowers are edible. Most people don't know you could eat them. They taste really floral. Other thing you guys can do is you can actually just bump off or break off the whole flowering top. So let's see, they've been doing pretty good at like chopping these back. So we're just gonna break off this whole tip, and you could use this like you would broccoli. Cook it up or just eat. I like to eat it raw. Quite good. The young flowering stems here, they're really tender, so you just break them off really easily. And these are also edible as well. So now you're eating the stems of the plants. Mmm. Sweet and tender at the tomato lady patch. Wow, that's actually quite good. And I want to let you guys know, you know, because I research these things, right? The leaves have different nutrients than the stems of the plant would, or the flowers of the plants have as well. In general, the leaves are more nutritious than the flowers or the stems, but to get a well-rounded variety of different phytonutrients and plant compounds, including trace minerals, I encourage you guys to eat all the different parts of the plant, from the flowers, the stems, and the leaves. That way you'll get the best nutrition out of the plants you're growing. I think it's quite sad when people grow the plants and they think they could only eat the leaves or only eat the part that they see in the grocery store. You know, we must remember, when you're buying things from the grocery store, it's what the agriculture system, industrial agriculture system, grows, and it's not efficient for them to be growing plants, the leaves, for the stems and the flowers and the seeds. Other thing I want to let you guys know is that you could also eat the seed pods. So I would encourage you guys to harvest the little seed pods that look like this, and you could eat these too. Mmm, these are quite good this time of year. You want to get the ones up not near the top. They're more tender. The ones near the bottom, as they get more mature, they get more hard. But yeah, eat your little seed pods too. They're delicious. All right, here's the next bed I want to show with you guys today. It actually has lots of different brassica family plants, which are anti-cancer and anti-aging. I would encourage you guys to eat them. And you know, while she is growing broccoli, most people grow broccoli for the little florets or the flower, you know, that they eat. But many people don't know that you could also eat the broccoli leaves. She has so many leaves in here that she could eat, just add into different cooked dishes. Once again, I like juicing them or blending them on up to get rid of them really fast and get some of those beneficial anti-cancer and nutritious compounds in you. So she's got a couple different kinds of brassicas. She's got the Pac-Man broccoli, she's got the standard dinosaur kale, she's got the red Russian kale, and she's got some Georgia collards. Another tip I want to give you guys directly from Leslie is, if you look at her little plant tags, these plant tags are the Venetian blinds, right? She has old Venetian blinds that are getting old, she just uses them and cuts them off and uses them as plant tags. So I think I learned that from her many years ago. You know, I always want you guys to label your plants so you know what you're growing. The other thing you can do is also label the date that you planted them or you started the seed, so you can have a record of that. This one, the Georgia collard, were planted 8/4/22, so you can see how far along they are. And actually, the Georgia collards to me look like they're growing pretty nice, not bolting yet. So, you know, for her August planting, that's probably when she started the seeds, doing pretty good. I usually plant from transplants because I don't have time to start all my seeds myself, and I'll usually start planting them out in maybe September, maybe even into October, and I'm actually still planting right now in December from plant starts. All right, the next bed I want to show you guys is her lettuce and miscellaneous greens bed. I love the lettuce bed. Look at this, she's planted, interplanted different colors of lettuce in there, including like red lettuces, green lettuces, red lettuces, green lettuces, and then a multicolor, you know, leaf lettuces. And you can see some of her lettuces are actually bolting. She's also got some parsley, cilantro. Yes, now's the time to plant cilantro in the winter time, not in the summer. It'll bolt really fast in the summer. And if you grow it in the winter, cilantro will be the first thing to bolt in my garden normally, but actually for her, it's her lettuce that she planted early. And of course, she's also planting some radishes. And yeah, we did have a freeze last night, but these plants will all survive a freeze because they have what's known as plant antifreeze, so they don't freeze like tomatoes or peppers would. And let's go over some of the varieties she's growing right now. She's got the Outback lettuce that in general looks like it's doing pretty good. Some plants are bolting already. She's got the wildfire lettuce. That's the red one right here. She planted this 8/5/22 from seed. And so, you know, to me, that's too early because that's still August. Man, we're still quite hot in August. And you could see the result of planting a little bit too early is that it's bolting. So maybe start this like a month later in September and it wouldn't have been bolting. Same thing for the Jericho lettuce. Looks like this is a, didn't like the being stressed out when it was young and it's starting to bolt. But of course, even when it's bolting, she's got lots of beautiful leaves to eat. Next coming up, she's got the butter lettuce crunch going on in this row. Looks like it's doing pretty good. She's got some romaine lettuce. Over in this row, looks like she's got some lettuce radicchio, some radicchio lettuce. Definitely just have some bug damage on it. She grows organically here. She's got the forest green parsley that's doing really nice, clumping up. Once again, started from seed, 8/5/22. The cilantro looking beautiful, as well as Easter egg radishes that are probably pretty much ready to harvest at this point, down on the final part of the row. All right, so now we're down to the back 40 where she has more raised beds, one out of cinder blocks and a bunch out of the plastic lumber here. And looks like they're holding up well. I remember them being here like 10 years ago and they're still growing good. And she's got lots of different things growing. Once again, more leafy greens. You know, the main thing you'll be growing in the winter time are the leafy greens, all different varieties, as I also grow the sugar snap peas, you know, a vining kind of fruiting crop for the winter time. But she's got more brassica family plants, beets and lettuces. She's got some more bok choy, cilantro, parsley, and even carrots back here planted. I wanna go over and do a close up on her garlic because she is famous for growing her garlic here in Las Vegas. And garlic and onions, another two amazing crops you can grow here in the winter in Vegas without issue. All right, so you guys can see, we got a whole bed here of garlic, and garlic's one of the easiest things you guys could plant. You just plant the little cloves in there, you know, probably planted that around September, and then they just pop up, right? And then you could grow your own garlic. I know for the longest time, Leslie was growing the Enchilium Red variety, and that's her favorite variety to grow here. And she would just grow mounds and mounds of garlic every single winter time. And it looks like she's still doing that. She's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 beds of garlic growing. I remember sometimes I'd drive by her house in the winter and she'd have the whole front yard covered in garlic. Now she's just, you know, reducing the amount she's growing, but she still has plenty of garlic growing here in the backyard. So another low maintenance fruit tree. If you guys want to grow fruit here in Vegas, it's going to be super simple, super easy. You guys learn the Meyer lemons, improved Meyer lemons do really well. But the pomegranate tree also, the fruits have been harvested and the leaves drop for the season. And probably come January, that's when she's gonna trim this back to kind of keep it smaller and compact. But the pomegranate really grows simply and easily in Las Vegas. And it's one of the most nutrient dense fruits you could grow with all its different elagitannins and different, you know, anthocyanin compounds. Like, do not underestimate the power of the pomegranate. Lately, I made like a tangerine pomegranate juice and it was delicious. Another thing Leslie will do is that she starts rooted cuttings of her successful fruit trees so that you guys could grow the exact same variety. You could see how well her fruit trees have done. And you know, you guys could know you'll get the exact same genetic clone of the one she did. So if you kill it, it's on you because she's proven that you guys could grow these specific varieties here in Las Vegas. And that's one of the challenges I see with plant nurseries that bring in things. And you know, you may not be 100% successful growing that particular variety. You know, if you don't particularly get the right kind of apple, you know, apples are not gonna do well here in the desert unless you get the one that has, you know, that needs less chill hours than others, right? So I like that she actually is starting things like pomegranates and some of her citrus and making them available for you guys. In addition, sometimes of the year, she'll also sell plant starts as well, so you'll have to inquire and ask her about that if she has any extra to sell. All right, so I just had to show you guys these because Leslie showed me this. These fruit trees here are like 10 years old, as she probably planted them here about 5 years ago, and they're really small. You know, they stay only maybe one, maybe like no taller than 4 feet tall. I'm like sitting down here. These are actually miniature fruit trees. So this is actually the Bonanza Miniature Peach by Dave Wilson Nursery. And they don't really get any taller than this. She just has to prune like the interior, but they really don't get that tall because it's on a, like not even a dwarf, but a miniature rootstock. She says she gets good harvests from these peach trees, right? She wanted to grow these specific miniature fruit trees here so it doesn't block the view of the garden from the basically short-term rental she has behind me, like a self-enclosed unit. That's your own little private space, so you could like literally come to Vegas on vacation and rent a garden unit here and like literally have Leslie's garden at your footsteps when you're vacationing and doing all the amazing things there are to do here in Las Vegas. So Leslie knows a thing or two about gardening, and one of the things she's learned, and she's like, she was so excited to tell me, she's like, John, most people harvest their grapefruits way too early. I mean, I was just in a store today and saw that they're trying to sell you grapefruits that are still kind of got a green on them. And this is like a ruby red grapefruit that she grows. And she's like, John, the problem with most people is that they harvest their grapefruits too early, right? And she's like, most people might harvest in December, but really you want to wait till February to harvest them, right? And she showed me, like, look at this. This is a red ruby. If we open this leaf up, look, it's starting to turn the red blush on there, right? And when it gets more ripe, if she leaves it on the tree a little bit longer, they're going to get sweeter and even more delicious. You know, and these are the kind of things you will learn from Leslie that you won't be able to learn anywhere else because she's experienced all these things. She's tried to harvest them early. She's like, oh, these don't taste good. Then maybe she left them on longer. She harvested them later, and then they tasted good. So, you know, as gardeners, we're always learning and growing. And I want you guys to pay attention to what you're doing in your garden, when you're harvesting things, how it's going, how it's tasting, and always experiment. I mean, that's one of the joys of gardening that I have that I'm sure Leslie still has, even in her 80s. All right, so I just want to give a little plug here during this episode to show you guys that if you're looking to come on vacation to Las Vegas, you need a place to stay, right? Some of the places in the Las Vegas Strip could cost really a lot of money. Leslie has quite affordable, you know, short-term rentals available. One of them is right behind me, which literally overlooks her amazing garden, which is currently occupied, so I can't show you guys in there. But she has another little smaller space that I want to take you guys in and show you guys the view that you could have of her garden every single morning when you wake up here in Las Vegas. I'm going to show you guys in her short-term rental she has. Look at this. Just really decorated nice. You got your own private bedroom with a desk, a microwave, coffee maker, TV. Even got a fireplace, a chair to relax on. And then check it out, we got a little bathroom here, and I want to show you guys a view from the bathroom, right? Wake up in the morning, and you can look out the window to her beautiful garden right out the backyard. So yeah, this is actually nice, tidy, and neat place to stay if you need an affordable stay in Las Vegas. So as much as you guys learned some of the varieties that Leslie grows in the wintertime, and to be honest with you guys, a lot of the leafy greens will pretty much just grow without issue in the wintertime. So you don't have to get as particular as you do with the summer. So when it comes to the summer, that's when you really got to pay attention and grow the right varieties. And I've definitely learned this myself through trial and error, but so has Leslie. And so that's why she wants you to be successful. Not only will she give you private classes that I mentioned earlier that I'll talk to her about in just a little bit, but she will also sell you the specific seeds that you will need that you should be starting probably in January so that you could be successful growing too. Because if you don't have the right variety of tomato, it's not going to produce well because it's not a heat tolerant variety or a heat tolerant variety of peppers, for example. So she has a seed rack here that if you guys want to buy these seeds, you got to come and visit here in the garden to buy them. She does not ship these, but she has different kinds of eggplants you could buy, the watermelons, butternut squashes, sugar pumpkins, autumn gold pumpkins, different kinds of peppers, tomatoes that'll grow well, the kinds of basil and specific squashes and beans that she's proven will grow well here in the desert of Las Vegas. She's got all her tomatoes, her different kinds of cucumbers, her pickles, different kinds of bunching onions, the kind of lettuces she loves to grow as well, radishes. Yeah, she's got all the varieties of seeds here so that you guys could be successful. You know, if you guys are looking for seeds for Las Vegas, right? Yeah, while I love some online seed sellers, they're great, right? You want to come to Leslie to get the specific varieties that are going to do well so that you have literally an ace in the hole, like you're gambling at the casinos. You got an ace in the hole because you already got the right varieties. So you just have to dial in the other aspects of growing in Las Vegas that Leslie could teach you. And actually what we're going to do next is actually we're going to sit down with Leslie and I'm going to interview her and hopefully get some download to you guys on some of her best tips and tricks to grow in Las Vegas, as well as learn how you could take private classes or semi-private classes from Leslie here in the garden. All right, so now the pleasure of interviewing Leslie Doyle, also known as the Tomato Lady here in Las Vegas. And actually, I was in her very garden like 10 years ago. I actually interviewed her in the shade that time. This time we could be more out in the garden today because it's a little bit cooler temperatures here in the winter time. And she moved here in 1990 and literally started gardening here 30 years ago. So she has 30 years of experience literally under her belt. And she's been teaching gardening to people that have been moving to Vegas all these years, because she also moved from a, you know, more northern climate where she couldn't grow the same things. So actually, before I even go on, she has two books. You cannot buy these in print anymore. They're out of print because they're so popular, but you can get digital downloads of these. You can get them on her website at sweettomatotestgarden.com. These are critical if you want to grow tomatoes in the desert, or you just want to be able to grow in the desert, with her slam dunk gardening booklet. I own both these. She gave them to me 10 years ago, and they are a wealth of information so that you too can be successful growing in Las Vegas and learning just a little bit from her knowledge of growing here. So Leslie, I got a few questions for you. First off, I know you're really creative and an artist and make all these little amazing things. You painted so many cool little like garbage cans and all kinds of things. You gave me this little thing here. It says, "You are amazing." She sells these in like little gift stores in Vegas. It's a fridge magnet. But aside from your, you know, being an artist, you also have been growing a lot of food here for a long time. So what originally got you motivated to grow food here in one of the most challenging places in the United States to grow food?
Well, I planted a tomato and it died.
Haven't we all?
And the next one died, and I asked people, and they said, you can't grow tomatoes in Las Vegas. And now you can grow tomatoes everywhere. And of course you can. So I just took it upon myself to find out the best way to grow tomatoes in the desert. And I succeeded.
So what are some of your tips for people that want, I mean, of course, all your tips are in the book, but what are some of the top tips that you would tell people that want it? Because the season's coming up. I mean, you just started your famous Hawaiian tropic tomato seedlings right here, started on 12, 13, 22. They're already popping up, you know, aside from using the right variety. Well, I don't want to take your thunder away, but what are some tips that you would give people?
Well, myself, I don't like to transplant out into the garden until the bugs have hatched and died. You know, the end of March, a lot of people want to plant in
too
February.
Early.
Yeah, plant too early. So we start these for sale. Some people grow them in greenhouses here, so these are available for early people. But we start our seeds here typically on Valentine's Day, and that makes the plants a nice size to transplant in the garden when the nights are warm. And we grow them, we water very low volume of watering, every 2 hours in drip irrigation. So they're always moist, always. And we adjust the flow rate depending on the size of the plant so we don't overwater. We can water exactly 8 inches deep, which is more than enough for tomatoes. And we grow them on the ground. We grow them in full sun, especially don't put down shade cloth for summer veggies. It's a terrible thing. Your issue is not the sun. Your issue is not watering correctly. But I've got a lot of other tips in my book, and when you come to my classes, you'll learn. We actually increase the light. We don't have a problem with too much light in Las Vegas. It's just the opposite. So we grow with a lot of silver reflective mulch and good soil and regular fertilizer. And we pick, out of this bed right here, we pick 150 pounds a day of big tomatoes. And it's not hard to do at all. We'll show you how.
She'll show you how to do it for sure. So
big ones, like on the cover of the book, the tomato book.
Yeah, look at these big tomatoes in Vegas. Now, I still haven't mastered growing tomatoes this big, so when I want big tomatoes, come to Leslie. I like to grow the cherry. That's my tip for you guys.
Well, you just have to do what I suggest. Men don't listen to you. You can do it.
I could do it if I followed, if I did all her stuff.
I do it.
But yeah, you can do it. So Leslie, what are some of your winter gardening tips for people out there? Because, I mean, for me, winter gardening is the best time to garden in Vegas. The summer, yeah, that gets more challenging, but the winter's so easy. So many different leafy greens will go fairly well in the winter without much hassle.
Well, one of the things about growing, you know, for your food is you don't want to plant all your seed all at once. Otherwise, you end up with 15 to 30 heads of broccoli or garlic or cauliflower. You can't eat those all at once. We like to plant every 10 days to 2 weeks so we have a constant supply. And the other thing is you have to start early enough. People usually are afraid to start their winter gardens in the summer because it's too hot. They wait till it's too late and they don't get as much crop as they could. We plant seeds every 10 days to 2 weeks to keep a constant supply of food for our table. But we start transplanting. We don't plant from seed into the garden. We grow everything indoors and get it to size and harden it off, and then it goes into the garden. And we like to put it in the garden before before Labor Day. And that offends a lot of people. But we're able to pick a huge amount of vegetables just when the nights are getting cool and everything is growing well. It's a good time to plant. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'd agree with that. I plant some of my things early, like she recommends, and right now they're to good size and they're still productive for me. Of course, because I have so much to plant and just myself, some of the things get planted later, so I'm still planting plants in December from little transplants, and they're going to grow a lot slower because we just don't have the sun, and of course, the temperature's a lot cooler these days.
Yeah, it's a good thing. You can plant every day of the year here. You don't want to plant if it's snowing or raining, yeah. But you can literally plant and harvest food every day of the year. We harvest something here every day. If it isn't nuts or lemons or grapefruits or kumquats, it's winter veggies, cauliflower, cabbages. In the summertime, it's the kale and the peppers and the tomatoes and just a wonderful plethora of food. You just have to get my planting calendar. It works for me.
Yeah, you got to get her planting calendar for sure. And if you guys don't want to buy her books and you guys live local, even better than getting her booklet and reading it and not following the directions if you're a guy, is to go and get a personal, private, or semi-private class from Leslie directly. So Leslie, you want to tell everybody about your classes on how you teach them how to start their seeds in little reusable containers like this and how they can learn directly from you with a hands-on small class size?
I used to do the big classes. I don't do that anymore. We don't seat 100 and 150 people here anymore, just for the talking classes. But if you actually want to start some seeds and have a little bit more private instruction, I'll do that any time of the day whenever you're available. I'm retired. This is all I do is talk to people and paint rocks. But I'll seat up to three people. I could squeeze in four, but three people. A husband, a wife, a child, a husband, both their wives, and a child. I'll go to four. It doesn't matter, but small, because we'll be inside in the office, and you'll get to see the light tables and all of what we sell, all of our seeds. We must have 200 varieties of seeds we can sell. And the silver mulches and there's just a whole bunch of stuff. But we'll do it in the classroom is in the office. I have a big office. And we'll sit down and we'll talk. And it's easier for me to answer all of your questions and direct it more to your needs in a small group like this, which I enjoy more. And I wish you'd come. So the classes right now, this year, this spring, are $30 for a seed starting class, and they last not more than an hour and a half, and you'll get to plant five varieties of the season we're in, five varieties of seeds, and then you'll take them home and you'll grow them out and pot them up, and I'll show you how to do that. And that includes the seeds. So, but I just want everybody to know that you can grow here, and it's just wonderful, so I'm not gonna send you home empty-handed. $30, yeah. You should call me, just call me up.
What's your phone number?
Oh, it's 702-472-3258. Call me in that phone. That's my cell phone. And tell me when you'd like to come, and I'll look at my calendar, and We start about 10 o'clock in the morning, and the last class is 6 o'clock at night, and you'll be finished by 7:30 and out the door, and you'll learn a lot. And as I say, it's $30 a person. And come ahead, call me. I do this all day long. You know, some day isn't we don't have 9 people coming. Sometimes we only have 3 classes during the day, but I'll squeeze you in. Whenever you're ready, call me.
Wonderful. I'm so glad you're doing personal, private, or semi-private classes there, Leslie, because, I mean, I wish I could do that. Maybe one day when I'm retired, I'll have the time to give private classes, but there's no way I can even fit anything extra in my schedule this time.
Fabulous. It's fabulous. I get to meet such nice people in small groups and just one-on-one sometimes, and we end up friends. It's great. But that includes a tour of the garden, and you'll love it. It's real hands-on experience. And I sympathize with what you're going through when your plants are failing. I've been there. I've killed more plants than anybody.
More plants than me.
Yes, I have. It's true. Sadly.
But yeah, I mean, I know you guys are into watching YouTube videos, but there is no substitute for, like, literally hands-on personal private experience that Leslie will give you and answer all your questions when you're come visiting her and taking a direct class from her, and she's going to give you guys a download. So I, you know, encourage you guys, if you guys have failed in Las Vegas before, like a lot of comments I see, right, come take Leslie's class, $30. The $30 is nothing, because in the future and how much food you're going to grow because of this lady's knowledge and what she's willing to share with you guys, it's going to make it easily worth your while. Plus, she's going to include the plant starts and the seeds to grow those plant starts so you could take them home and be instantly successful. So I think that's an amazing service you provide to people out here in Las Vegas, Nevada. So yeah, check her out. Give her a call. So Leslie, another thing I want to ask you about before we go is that I know for some people that like have never been to Vegas and they want to come to Vegas on vacation, right? You have some short-term vacation rentals. So you just want to mention briefly about them. If somebody wants to come to Vegas on vacation, they could like literally stay in your garden. Like what better amazing place could you stay at? Like on the strip with all the people, or just come stay in a relaxed area where you could just open your door and see tomatoes and peppers and lettuce growing in the wintertime.
Yeah, I have the best life in the world. If friends come here and people come from Airbnb, I may be off of Airbnb soon, but you can call me up. I have a lovely guest house here. I built it for myself for when I need to live in a smaller place. And I've got a little studio apartment. They're very inexpensive. And I also book them for family classes, teaching how to garden. And the education is included, and you can come for 2 days. But call me up and discuss it. We didn't do the interior of the guest house on this film to show you because it's rented. I've got somebody in there for a couple more days from Utah. And but you saw the studio.
Yeah, I saw the studio. I showed him the studio. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a good place. It's a good place. It's really nice. I've met wonderful people. Gardeners are fabulous people. Yeah. You're all welcome. You're all welcome. Inexpensive.
All right, Leslie, so the time with me is coming to an end because it's getting cold out here in the day, middle of December. But a few more things for you. Number one, I want you guys to get on her email list because she does also give free classes, which, you know, you're not going to learn as much as a hands-on class, obviously. But in the springtime, she'll have, you know, people come in and just do a free class because she just wants people to garden. I mean, I want people to garden in Las Vegas and be successful at it. So, Leslie, how can somebody learn about your free gardening classes you have during certain times of the year?
Yeah, well, I publish them as we're going to have them on my website, www.sweettomatotestgarden.com, which is going through maintenance issues now. So it's in and out and not fully populated yet, but it will be. And on that website, you'll see a place where you can sign up for the newsletter, or you can send me an email. tomato@cox.net. And tomato is not spelled T-O-E. There's no E on the end, unless you're a vice president. Former vice president.
So tomato@cox.net, and just give her your email address to get on her email list, and you'll get notified when she has the free classes. Of course, that's another way to contact her if you guys want to do one of her affordable $30 paid classes as well. So, Leslie, the last question I have for you today before we sign off is, What's the biggest tips that you want to give people that grow in Vegas that they do it wrong, that if they just started changing these things, they could be more successful?
Well, the experience that I have with that is comes from the Master Gardener desk answering the problem hotline there for years when I was a Master Gardener. And people seem to be watering incorrectly and shading their plants. Those two issues seem to be the major reason for crop failure. But there's five things that you have to, absolutely have to do, and we'll run that class, run by those things, and you'll find out that it's not more difficult to garden in the desert. It's actually easier. You have less bugs.
Yeah.
You inherit a lot. You don't inherit a lot of the problems that people live, where people live in the rain, and we don't have issues that the rest of you have. So you can really have fabulous plants. We picked onions couple of months ago that were 3 pounds.
Each?
And, yeah.
Wow.
And then our tomatoes this year weighed between 1.5 and 2.5 pounds, and they were delicious. But we got a prolific amount of vegetables. And because of the way we grow, they're not damaged by insects and creatures. We really do have a lot of stuff to teach you that you've never heard of before. So I hope you'll call me, and I hope you'll come over. We try to keep it really cheap so everybody can go, but I still get paid for dinner, breakfast, gasoline. Anyway, come and see me. We'll have a good time. You'll learn a lot.
Wonderful. Yeah, thank you, Leslie, for having me out today. And if you guys live in Las Vegas or even the surrounding area, I highly encourage you guys to take a class from Leslie directly so that she could download to you guys all her knowledge so that you too could be successful gardening in Las Vegas. It's much more than just watching a few of my YouTube videos, getting her in person to answer all your questions. I cannot emphasize enough how much I've learned from this lady, from just the times I've visited her, from, you know, looking at her little booklets that she's given me over the years. I mean, that's why, I mean, I attribute some of my success of growing in Vegas to Leslie, because, I mean, she was doing it before me, you know, and, you know, especially the watering and the non-shading things, because I've experimented on my own with shading and non-shading, and I've come up with what she's come up with, right? I learned that, you know, it's better just to have it unshaded. It just makes things so much easier, but you really need to kind of pay more attention to the plants, you know, and do things a bit differently, because if you come from a northern climate, you got to relearn actually how to grow food successfully in the desert, and actually, so we have to learn, you know, and that's the biggest thing, and that's what you can learn from Leslie. So if you guys enjoy this episode, want me to do more videos at Leslie's in the future, hey, please be sure to give this video a big thumbs up, and more importantly, share this with other gardeners in Vegas. Share it on Facebook groups so that they could learn about Leslie and the amazing garden she's growing here and the amazing knowledge she's sharing with you guys at affordable prices. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I'll be coming out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teaching you guys all about how to grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.